Welcome back. We'll understand one of the major topics for this year, that's the President of India and the election of President of India. Now, this is a very, very important topic considering the fact we had a new president this year, and therefore the election process and the major facts about president are very, very important. Now, coming on to the basic salient features, we know the president is considered as the executive legislature and the judiciary head. He resides at Rashtrapati Bhavan in New Delhi. However, the presidential retreats are in Shimla, that's Chhabra, and then the Rashtrapati Nilayam in Hyderabad. So these are the two retreats of the President of India. Now, what are the qualifications to be required for becoming the President of India? Under Article 58, it's mentioned that the President must be a citizen of India, minimum has a 35 years of age, should not hold any office under profit. That's a very, very important concept. However, there is a kind of exception to this where we say he can hold an office as the governor, as the vice president. However, he cannot hold any office under profit. So that's a very important point to know here. And again, he should be qualified for elections as a member of Lok Sabha. Now, coming on to the election of president, which is very, very important. It occurs through the process of single transferable vote mentioned under Article 54. Now, the president is elected by electoral house. Electoral house is composed of members of parliament and members of the legislative assemblies, along with the two union territories, which include the NCT, that's the National Capital Territory of Delhi, and Pondicherry. So these are the two important union territories which are part of the Presidential Electoral College. Now, MPs form the member of Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, and MLAs are from the respective state. Now, the process of election is a kind of indirect election. What happens is, the proportion of the vote for the MPs and the MLAs are decided, which we'll understand as we move forward. And based on that, you have the value of the vote that is being defined. Now, the term of the president in India is 5 years as compared to United States where it's 4 years. In India, we say we have a parliamentary form of government. However, in United States, we have a presidential form of government. Again, in India, there can be re-elections any number of times, and the same president can be re-elected any number of times. However, in United States, re-election is allowed only once. That means the president can become president in United States only for 2 consecutive terms, not more than that. Now, very important fact, the oath of the president is given by the Chief Justice of India, and in the absence of Chief Justice of India, it's the most senior member of the Supreme Court who gives the oath to the President of India. Now, the one candidate who wants to be proposed as the president will have to file a deposit amount of 15,000 as security. Now, this could be fortified in a specific condition if the candidate is not elected and the number of valid votes which are being polled for such candidate is less than 1/6. So, in that case only, the deposit would be fortified, otherwise it would be paid back. As we said, in case the president is currently holding a position of vice president, governor, prime minister or council of minister, then he can hold that office and apply for the president's post. However, he cannot hold any office under profit, as we discussed before. Now, talking about the election process. Election process is very, very interesting. It is laid down under the 84th Constitutional Amendment Act of 2001, which says that the population would be considered for the 1971 as a base year. It would be only revised after 2026. And after that, the new census would be published and the new population would be counted only after 2026, which was given in the 84th Constitutional Amendment. Now, since we are taking 1971 as the base year, we are taking the number of members in the Electoral College for 2017. Now, when we calculate it for 2017, we have 233 members of Rajya Sabha, we have 253 members from Lok Sabha, and 4,120 members from state assemblies or MLAs, and the total number of votes would be 4,896. Now, how these votes are divided among and how these votes become valid, let's understand that. So, a simple thing to understand here is, first, the proposers and the seconders give the name in the nomination. So, let's say I propose the name of candidate A, my another colleague proposes the name of candidate B, and so on. So, what happens is, this candidate must have at least 50 MLAs or MPs who are proposing his name, and this candidate again must have minimum of 50 MLAs and MPs out of this 4,896 who are proposing their names. Only once they have these many candidates, they would be considered for the nomination of the presidential election. Again, if I am proposing the names, I can propose the names for more than one candidate. So, I can propose the name of A as well as B. So, that's one thing to note. Now, calculating the value of votes. The value of votes of an MLA is very, very interesting because it is defined by the population of the state and the number of seats. So, let's say we are taking an example of Andhra Pradesh. The Andhra Pradesh has this much population and there are 175 number of seats. So, the number of votes of each member would be 159. And the total value of the votes would be 159 into the number of the seats. And this would be 27,000 would be the total value of votes from Andhra Pradesh. So, this was the calculation of the value of votes for MLA. Now, coming on to MPs, the calculation of the value of votes would be total number of total value of the votes of MLA. So, we have calculated the value of the vote for Andhra Pradesh. Then we will add all the values from all different states. And then that would become the total value of the votes of MLAs here. And then we will have the total number of MPs, which are 533. And we will divide the total value of the votes with the total number of MPs. And we get the value of vote of each member of parliament is 708. Now note, we classified the electoral house under two heads, MPs and MLAs. The value of vote of an MP is 708. However, the value of vote of an MLA would vary. For Uttar Pradesh, it is 208. However, for Sikkim, it's only 7. That means the states with higher population would have higher value of the votes. So, you have Uttar Pradesh with around 208 value. However, Sikkim with only 7. But again, the value of votes of MLA is much less as compared to MP. So, that's again very important to note. MPs would have, the members of parliament would have the higher value of vote as compared to the MLAs. Now, what would happen is, the total value of the votes of the MPs and the MLAs are calculated. So, the total value of votes of MLAs is this much and the total number of MPs are the Lok Sabha members plus the Rajya Sabha members, that comes to 766. We divide these and find the value of votes is 708. That's for 2017 we are talking about. Now, this value of vote would be multiplied by the total number and we'll get the total value for the MPs. Now, we have the total value of the vote for the MPs. We also have the total value of the vote for the MLAs. So, you have the MLA's total value and the MP's total value. And we add these two. So, we have the total value of the votes as 10 lakh and something. Now, we have the total electorals as 5,000, nearly 5,000. So, what happens is, now the polling takes place. And under the polling, you have the MPs which are given the green slip and the MLAs which are given the pink slips. Now, this voting does not take place through the electronic voting machine, first of all. It occurs through the ballot paper. So, what happens is, on the ballot paper, you have candidate A, B and C. What I have to do, I as an MP or an MLA would have to mark down my preferences. So, let's say I mark down the preference 1, 2 and 3. And another candidate for A, B and C candidate marks down the preferences 1, 2 and 3. And that happens in the nomination and in the election of the president. Now coming on to the powers of the president. Powers of the president are explained under different heads. So first let's talk about legislative power. Legislative power, the president has the power to summon both the houses of the parliament, that's the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, and he has the power to dissolve Lok Sabha. All the bills can become law only after the presidential assent under the Article 111. Then president also has the right to withhold the assent of the bill, and this is when it is initially presented to him, and he can also exercise the pocket veto on advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers under Article 74. Executive power. President has the duty to enforce decrees of the Supreme Court under Article 142. Judiciary powers, he appoints the Chief Justice of India and the major judges of the Supreme Court. He can dismiss the judges if and only if 2/3 of the parliament pass a resolution that is by that occurs by the 2/3 majority of the members present. Now he has a very crucial role in appointments. President appoints the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers, the 12 members of Rajya Sabha who are the nominated members, the governors of the state, the Chief Justice of India, the Chief Minister of Delhi, Attorney General, Comptroller and Auditor General and the Chief Election Commissioner. Besides that, the chairman of and the members of UPSC, the Union Public Service Commission, the Vice Chancellors of the Central University and the ambassadors and the High Commissioners to other countries are appointed by the President directly. Under the financial power, there are three major financial powers. He lays down the annual financial statement, takes advances from the contingency funds of India. He can constitute a financial committee after every 5 years, and the money bill can be introduced in parliament only with the recommendation of the president. He has numerous diplomatic powers because he has the right to negotiate on agreements on behalf of the president. The agreements can be negotiated. He also has the right to send and receive various diplomats in India and abroad. Military power, he is the supreme commander of the defense forces. He appoints the chiefs of the armed forces and he can declare war or conclude peace based on the advice of the Supreme Court. He has the right to pardon the candidates who have been given the life sentence or death sentence, who have been accused under military punishment or are under the offense of offense against union. If they are punished under the offense against union, they can also be pardoned by the President of India. President do has the emergency power. He can have both the external and the internal emergency. He has the right during both the emergencies. It is during the financial emergency that president has the right to reduce the salary of the government officials. However, no such financial emergency has taken place so far. So far, there have been 3 national emergencies that have occurred. One was during the president S. Radhakrishnan during the Indochina war. The next was during the president V.V. Giri's time when it was Indo-Pakistan war. And these were due to the external aggression. The third emergency was due to an internal phenomena. And what we basically know, it was during the Indira Gandhi's period. But it was president who declared the emergency, and the president that time was Farukuddin Ahmad. So these are the basic highlights and the powers of the president. Now coming on to the differences between the President of United States and President of India. As we previously talked about, United States has a presidential form of government, India has a parliamentary form of government. In United States, the tenure for the president is 4 years. He can be re-elected only once. In India, the term is 5 years and he can be re-elected any number of times. In India, the election is by indirect means. In United States, it's direct election process. In United States, he is the head of the state and the head of the government. But in India, he is a kind of titular head or just the head of the state. United States president has much veto power as compared to President of India. He also has the pocket veto, but he can use a pocket veto in different senses compared to Indian president. What he can do is, if any bills come to his table, and he can keep that bill till the Congress dissolves, and as a result the bill would automatically die. However, that does not happen in India. He can keep the bill for as long as he wants, but that would not dissolve. He can also dissolve in India. President can dissolve the parliament, but in United States, president cannot dissolve the parliament. So India, pocket veto was first exercised by President Gyani Jail Singh with respect to Indian Postal Bill, which was passed by Rajiv Gandhi government, but this was later withdrawn in 1989. So with this, we covered the basic concepts of the President of India, the qualification, the eligibility, and most importantly, the electoral process. That's very, very important, specifically for your upcoming examination. So stay tuned. We'll do cover more chapters on GS and more topics, important topics for GS as well. So do subscribe to the channel. For any doubts or queries or clarifications, leave your comment below the video. Have a very good day ahead.